Okay, good morning to everybody. So let us start our third topic. So this topic is about second order methods, and we will discuss how they should be designed and what theory we can build around in order to justify their efficiency estimate and their rate of convergence. Okay, first of all, let me start from historical remarks. So we are speaking about the simplest unconstrained minimization problem. So we minimize nonlinear function without constraints. And actually, so we do not assume that our function is convex, and we treat so this our problem as a solution of first order optimality conditions, so which is that the gradient is equal to zero. Now, the Newton method looks as follows, and actually this is a linearization scheme. So you can easily see so the reason for this updating formula. So if we are staying at the point xk, okay, we can linearize the gradient around this point using the second order derivative and say that this gradient, this linearization is equal to zero. So, and so in this linear system, okay, we get this updating formula for our point. So very, very natural idea. But actually, you can easily see that this is just an idea, so idea of the method. It is not the method, really the method, because actually there are several difficulties which can happen. First of all, so nobody says that we are staying at the point where our Hessian is non-degenerate. So it may happen that we cannot invert the matrix, and then it is absolutely not clear what we should do in this situation. So in fact, so this means that the method stops and it doesn't reach its goal. Now, the method can be divergent. So even in one-dimensional situation, so if we consider the function like this, and we start, so this is the gradient prime of x, and we start far enough from the solution, for example, here, then linearization goes very far from our initial point, and clearly, so in this situation, so we will be divergent. And also, when we say that we are trying to solve the first order optimality condition, so first order optimality condition is satisfied not only by the minimums and by the local minimums, but also by the saddle points or even by the maximums. So for example, in function like this, okay, we can be attracted by this point, and actually what we want to find is this point. So the Newton method can be convergent to the wrong solution. And also, so in this form, actually, it is very difficult to guarantee some convergence, some, let me say, good behavior of this sequence, and there are examples where so such updating rules so create really chaotic behavior of the sequence. So what we can do with that? Actually, so Newton method is very old, so it is already more than 100 years old, and initially it was used in a paper by Bennett, where he used this scheme in order to prove the existence theorem for certain system of equations. So, but the practical implementation of this method, so they started immediately after development of the computers, first computers, and the first idea how to make this method better was the idea of linearization, regularization, I'm sorry. Yes. idea of regradation. So one possible difficulty with the Newton scheme if is that the Hessian of our function is not positive definite, and therefore if this is the case, we can try to improve this Hessian. We can try to add to this Hessian identity matrix with some positive weight, just to have the positive definite matrix, which is invertible, and then we can, of course, use this direction in order to update the point. So this idea was suggested in 1944 and later in 1963, so people were looking at practical implementation of this scheme. The first theoretical results about Newton methods were developed by Kantarovich in 1948, and these results are indeed important because so he proved the quadratic convergence, and what is important is the conditions which he introduced in order to prove this fact. So the assumptions were as follows. First of all, the function was smooth enough. Okay, the Hessian of this function, so the matrix of Hessian, this is the matrix norm. So is Lipschitz continuous, and the Hessian at the solution is positive definite. So if x0 is close enough to the optimal solution, then so we have quadratic convergence. So quadratic convergence, of course, is very very nice property. So I recall you what is it. So this is so when our arrow on the next step satisfies something like this, inequality like this. Okay. And look what happens, for example, if delta k is equal 10 to the minus 1. So for the next step, it is 10 to the minus 2. At the next, it is 10 to minus 4, 10 to minus 8. So each step of this method so doubles the number of right digits. And of course, so therefore, we cannot expect that the number of such steps will be big. So with the modern computers, so if we see the quadratic convergence, then actually it is a question of, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 steps and method stops. So therefore, in some sense, quadratic convergence so is more or less equivalent to finite termination of the scheme. But global convergence was not addressed. And actually, or it was addressed only on empirical level, so people just say that in order to have a stable behavior of this scheme, so we can do a line search along Newton direction, but this was mainly good advice because they didn't prove anything about the rate of convergence and so on. So global performance for the standard Newton scheme actually is not addressed up to now. So in the end of 90s, actually, so these people, so Kongold and Tuan, they published a very detailed and thick monograph about so another approach, second order approach, which is related to trust region idea. Trust region idea. So what is this? Actually, it is quite natural idea. So we, for at each point, we introduce a neighborhood of this point. So we are staying at the point, and we introduce a neighborhood of, around this point. So they usually, so for that, people use some norm. So norm can be even dependent on the iteration counter. So this neighborhood defines the trust region, so with radius delta k around the point. And then so we can minimize the quadratic model of our function where jk is either the Hessian or regularized Hessian. So at this set, the advantage is that then actually the steps cannot be too big, so we are staying in the neighborhood of our function. And so the picture which we had here, so with divergent behavior of the scheme now is not possible anymore. But still, so we need to understand what is our situation. So is it a good trust region or not? And for that, so after computing the trial points, the minimizing the model, so in this set, so we look at the ratio. So which is the, we compare the actual progress in the function value with the progress predicted by the model. Okay, if this ratio is good, so which means that our progress is good proportion of the predicted process, then this is okay. If this progress is bad, so we decrease the radius of trust region and we continue. So we solve the problem again and so on. So this is the very natural idea, okay? But of course, there are some advantages, disadvantages of this scheme. So the advantages is that actually, so this scheme is quite flexible. So we can decide about the norm, we can decide about the radius, we can decide about the acceptable ratio. So for the progress in the objective function, so we have good flexibility, but this means okay. Now what we can prove about this scheme? So we converge to a point which satisfies the second order optimality condition. So the first optimality condition is that the gradient is equal to zero, and second order optimality condition is the Hessian is positive semi-definite. For example, here we have second order optimality condition satisfied and here not. Okay. But also we have disadvantages of this approach. Disadvantages which somehow related with advantages. So one of them is that since we have many parameters, so it may be difficult to find the right strategy for coordination, how we choose that, how we change that, and all things like that. So complicated strategies for coordination. Now, the norm which we introduce and this flexibility of the norm is actually just an illusion, because the problem of minimizing quadratic function, even non-convex quadratic function, because sometimes we are working with non-convex problems, with the norms which are not Euclidean, are usually NP-hard problems. So the auxiliary problem becomes very difficult, and therefore, typically we have no reason to choose here non-Euclidean norms, because the auxiliary problem becomes very, very difficult. Now, so this idea to introduce the trust region so eliminates the possibility for line search, because somehow if we change the radius, so the points our solution, so of our model, are changing, but then they're changing not along the line, so it is quite complicated curve, and therefore so the standard line search strategies in this situation do not work. And also, so there are some theoretical difficulties. Actually, this is mainly the only thing which we can prove about different variants of trust region methods, and this is definitely not enough. So since about all methods we prove exactly the same statement, so and we have no global convergence analysis, so it is very difficult to argue that one scheme is better than another. So only computational experiments can help, but computational experiments is a very, let me say, dangerous knowledge, because in 10 years, so you need to redo everything from scratch, since the computers are changing and problems are changing and so on. Of course, the theoretical knowledge about such schemes is much more interesting. And here, so this is exactly what is missing. This is missing, by the way, up to now. And this is one of difficult and open problems in optimization theories, is the global complexity analysis of trust region methods. We're not going to discuss trust region methods anymore because we will look at another approach. We look at another approach which in which we do not have the majority of these disadvantages. But before, let us think a little bit how we develop the numerical methods. Actually, there are two types, two ways to develop new schemes. So one of them is a classical style, actually. So it was used not only in optimization, but in many other fields of numerical analysis. We look at the problem formulation and think what we could do with this. We think, and after that, so we decide why we don't try this nice idea. So and we get the method like this. Usually, so there is explanation why we're choosing this method, but all of them are kind of quite fuzzy. And in this way, so we develop the gradient method. So the explanation of gradient method is that the gradient is the direction of the fastest increase of a function. Therefore, let us go in the opposite direction. Right? Very nice idea. So, and Newton method also, why we don't linearize and accept so this solution of the linearized systems, and so on. If you look so what happens in with differential equations and other fields, so very often the classical method, the old classical method, so where they are developed in this way. But now we do something differently, actually, somehow differently, because in the modern style of developing of the method, so we have in mind not only the problem formulation, so we have also the problem class. So we already know for which problems we will apply our scheme. And only taking account the problem class and problem formulation, we develop the numerical method. So this, and the result is different, actually. So what we can find such examples, for example, all methods for non-smooth convex optimization. So the majority of them, they simply do not work if the function is not convex. Okay, so they work only with convex functions. For smooth optimization, so the things which we are considered in the previous lecture. So we know that our function is from the class C11. So from this knowledge, so we develop this concept of gradient mapping, which is just the solution of our model regularized by quadratic term. And we know why we are doing this, just because from the property that our function has Lipschitz continuous gradient. So we know that the model is an upper approximation of our objective function. Therefore, it is indeed reasonable to minimize this upper approximation, and this idea, so with which takes into account also the problem class, it works even with constraints, because constraints, so we don't care about constraints because we can minimize the same upper approximation with constraints, and we get very nice actually methods for which the rate of convergence for constraint case and non-unconstrained case is exactly the same. Okay, so it is important to remember that now we are trying to do something like that also, and to look again at our goal, so to solve the optimization problems by second order schemes, which where the function has Lipschitz continuous Hessian. So we just take this condition from Kantarovich paper and say, so this is it. Fine. So what are consequences? So from this inequality, so there are three important consequences. Let us look at the model, quadratic model of our function. We are staying at the point x, we linearize the function, we add the second order approximation, this is the Taylor approximation of our function, quadratic approximation. Now, if we look at the gradient of this quadratic function, then it will be approximation of the gradient. But of course, now it is a linear approximation of gradient, so exactly the things which we thing which we used here. Now, what we know about these approximations? Just simple integration tells us the follows. So the difference between the gradient and the linear prediction, which we do at the point x, so grows, so the norm of this difference, so at most quadratically. This is again a simple, very simple effect. And for the function value, the difference between the function value and quadratic prediction grows at least cubically. So we, and in both cases here we have the factor which depends on the Lipschitz constant on the Hessian. Yeah. So this is indeed very natural, I think, so you can prove this yourself, because intuitively it is more or less clear that L2 is an upper bound for the third derivative of our function, and this difference can be written as an integral of the third derivative. And therefore, we have this inequality. Okay, what is the corollary, actually? So from this simple inequality, we have immediately the corollary, which looks very similar to the thing which we had for the first order method. Yeah? Indeed, since this is true, we can say that the function in which we add the quadratic model, so this, this guy, okay, plus this cubic term is an upper approximation of our objective function. And we already had a similar construction, the first order scheme, where we had first order approximation and quadratic term. But for the second order scheme, so we have upper approximation in this form. So why we don't minimize this upper approximation of our functions in order to get new approximation of the solution of our problem? This is indeed very natural idea, and it leads to so-called cubic regularization of the Newton method. So what we are doing again, so M2 of xy, okay, so I don't know, so is it necessary to write it down, what is it, but try, so M2 of x, y, f x, plus f prime of x, y minus x, plus 1/2 okay, second order approximation. So we add for this the quadratic term, and so we minimize it. Yeah, note that in this situation, so we can work even with non-smooth function, so the non-convex function, so the Hessian can not necessarily positive definite, since in any case, so this cubic term is stronger when the distance is big, is stronger than the quadratic function, and therefore, so this function is below bounded, of course. So the set of global minimums of this function is not empty, and we will choose the point from the set of global minimum. Okay, computability. So this is, of course, an important question. Maybe it explains why this scheme was analyzed with very big delay in the optimization literature. So indeed, so if this function is not convex, and in the early years of nonlinear optimization, people were interested mainly in non-convex problem, then so this problem is also non-convex. Moreover, it can have many local minimums, and actually maybe exponentially many local minimums, and we have it's not clear how we can arrange the computation of the global minimum of this function. Yes, and actually you will see later that in order to get good results, so we need indeed we need to find the global minimum of these non-convex cubic functions. But fortunately, so this difficulty can be eliminated in the case if our norms are Euclidean. It appears that if our norm is Euclidean, then so this point can be computed from a simple convex optimization problem. So this I just show you what is the convex optimization problem. So our and this actually problem it is better to solve it using the duality, the dual form of this minimization problem. And this dual form is just one dimensional. So we have one variable R in our feasible set, which is non-negative, and for which this matrix is positive definite. Okay, so this is a convex constraint. This is a convex constraint for variable R, yes, because this is just ray in the cone of positive semi-definite matrices, and with these constraints, we need to maximize this function, which is concave. So this is minus R cube when R is greater than zero is a concave function. And this function is also with minus, it is concave. So this is our variable R. You see, so this global minimum can be obtained using this maximization problems. And actually, since it is one-dimensional, okay, so we can even write down so the first order optimality condition for this optimization problem, which is this. So at each iteration of this scheme, so we need to solve in R, so this equation. And this equation, actually, so maybe it is not very clear what is it, but in fact it is not dangerous. The equation is like this. So we have R in the left-hand side, and we intersected with decreasing function. So this is right hand side. So we need to find the root of this equation. Again, it's in one dimension, therefore this can be done very efficiently. And then so we know the formula for the step, so for the direction which is interesting for us. So, and again, so this is a theorem that this is indeed global solution of our optimization problem. Okay, we're in a nice result, and it explains why this cubic realization now it can be used in even for solving non-convex optimization problem. Fine. So let us look now at simple properties of this rule. So when we take this is T of M, so from the global minimum of this function. So what we can say? So let us look at the step size, so the norm of the displacement, then the first order optimality condition, so when you just differentiate this quadratic function plus the cubic regularization, so you get this first order optimality condition. This is the gradient of quadratic function, and this is the gradient of the regularization term in the solution of our problem, which is Tm of x. And also we have this second order optimality condition, which is satisfied at the solution, since this is the global minimum. So from these two things, actually, just multiplying this equality by x minus Tm at x, first we see that this direction from x to Tm of x is the direction of descent, so function is decreasing in this direction. Now, the progress of the model so is at least proportional to the cube of the displacement, and the displacement is at least as a square root of the norm of the gradient. Yeah, so from this we already can see, in fact, the expected rate of convergence of this guy. So because in the case when M, yeah, the regularization parameter is big enough, it is bigger than the Lipschitz constant, then of course this the value of the model is bigger than the value of the function, therefore the progress in the function value will be at least proportional. Look what happens. We substitute this guy here. Yeah, so we have fk minus fk plus 1 greater or equal than constant multiplied by the norm of the gradient at the new point, to the power 3 divided by 2. And now, so if we speak about convex function, so usually we can say that the norm of the gradient greater or equal 1 over r are the difference in the function value. Yeah. So we already have seen the reasoning like that. Therefore, from this and that, we see that the progress of the function is at least the difference in the function value. Another constant. To the power 3 divided by 2. And from that you already can guess what is the rate of convergence to zero. Because this relation between derivative of function let me write minus a to the power 3 divided by 2 corresponds to a of t equal 1 over t square. Yes? So the derivative of 1 over t square will be 1 over t cube, and 1 over t cube in the power 3 divided by 2. And this is 1 over t square to the power 3 divided by 2. So this guy satisfies this equation, therefore the cubic Newton. So we will see that statement a little bit later, but just from the beginning we already know what will be the rate of convergence. So the rate of convergence of the cubic Newton is already quite good, global rate of convergence for convex function. So this is just the immediate consequence of these two simple inequalities. Okay, and there are some other facts. So for example, this property, which is also, let me say, global property, that so if m is bigger, then this is bigger than that. So the value of our function at the new point is smaller than the minimum of our objective function plus this regularization term. And this regularization term locally it is very weak because it is third power, so it is very flat in the neighborhood of the point x. Therefore, indeed, so we can improve a lot our function value. So in optimization, so people look, they consider it such construction like what in proximal point algorithm, there is some theory for methods of this type where at each iteration we minimize auxiliary problem in y, and after that we get the new method. And this is of course is very heavy and difficult to do this. And here we have much better results just in one step without any additional minimization in y. Okay, so let us now look what we can prove for this cubic regularization of the Newton method. Now, first of all, we'll speak about the non-smooth version of the Newton scheme. Okay, you remember that the standard Newton. So we had a picture here. The standard Newton can be attracted by saddle points and by maximums. And the reason is, again, so I repeated that in the scheme, so we say that we want to solve the first order optimality condition, and both this point, they satisfy first order optimality condition. But now in the cubic realization method, so it is clear that we are going to minimize our function. Yes, because we solved the auxiliary problem of minimization, of minimizing the model plus quadratic term. Therefore, it behaves exactly as we would expect. So around this point. Okay, let us look what we can prove. So this is the saddle point. So the gradient of our function is equal to zero, and the Hessian is not a positive positive semi-definite. Then, so the method behaves as follows. So if we are close enough to this bad point, okay, and our function is bigger than the value of this point, then at the next iteration, so we just jump away from this guy, and we will never come back because the function is monotone. So if we are close to such points, so for the next iteration we go on the level which is smaller than this point. So the saddle point for this method, they are not the attraction point. So they're not that dangerous. Moreover, look, so what we can do in this method, so and which was impossible for gradient scheme, for example, so if we can even start from the point with zero gradient. And still, so if this is true, then we will go away from this point, so for example, point of the minimum or point, saddle point, so we can do that instead. And the local convergence is, of course, as we can expect, so we converge to the point which satisfies first order optimality condition and the second order optimality condition. Okay, moreover, so there is one important thing which appears to be new for nonlinear optimization. We can write down the rate of convergence for the norm of the gradient of our function. And this rate of convergence is proportional 1 to the k to the power 2 divided by 3. Yeah, so just the blackboard is very small, so I delete it. So we have seen that we have this inequality. Three divided by two. Therefore, when we sum up this inequality from initial point up to the end point, okay, we get that in the left hand side we will have the bounded value, and in the right hand side, so we will have the summation of the norm to the power three divided by two. Therefore, the smallest norm in the power 3 divided by 2 is decreasing proportionally to 1 over k, and the norm itself, so for that we just take the power 2 divided by 3 from 1 over k, so we get this, we get this result. And this result is better than the estimate for the gradient method. I recall you that for the gradient method, so the power here must be 2, not 3 divided by 2. Okay. For the gradient method, so the rate of convergence of the gradient of the norm of the gradient to zero is slower than this. So therefore we see that Newton method is more efficient. And local convergence is of course quadratic. This is what we can expect, because we add to the quadratic model the cubic term, and when we close to the optimal solution, the cubic term is much weaker than the quadratic. Therefore, we do not destroy the local quadratic convergence of this method. Now, let us look at the global guarantees of this scheme. So one of them, so we will look at the different problem classes and see so what we can guarantee for the in terms of the global performance. And one of them, so the first class, So it's so-called star convex functions. You remember the definition of the convex function. So convex function is like that. So any chord in the graph is above the graph of the function. So this is definition. But for convex function, this should be true for all points x and y. Here we need this property only at the segment which connects the optimal point of our function with point x. So we need this only along this line. So if this is true, then so we have the following situation. Actually, the complexity results, which we will see for the Newton method, for second order scheme, they always have the same structure. So the optimization process is divided on two parts. So the first one, which is usually very short, guarantees that the function value is close enough to it goes below certain level. So usually this certain level depends on the Lipschitz constant, on the Lipschitz constant for the Hessian. So look how it works here. So if our initial point is big enough, then the first point in the next point is already smaller, much smaller than this constant. So in one step, so we go above a certain level of the objective function. Now, if we're already here, so this means that we start from this process x1, then so we have the rate of convergence which is proportional to 1 over k squared. And the reasoning for this 1 over k squared is exactly this inequality we have discussed here, that from for Newton method, so we can expect the convergence as 1 over k squared. This is exactly what we can prove here, more or less by the same reason. Now, what happens if our function is non-degenerate? So it appears that non-degeneracy helps in the end, and also here we can speak about weak non-degeneracy. So the usual non-degeneracy tells us that function grows with respect to the optimal point at least quadratically. So there is a quadratic support for the value of our function in terms of the distance from the optimal point. Here we do not say that. We say that we allow the optimal set, the optimal point, to be non-unique. So it can be some set. Okay, and we want our function to grow quadratically, if you want, in the orthogonal subspace. So which means that, okay, so the value of the function is bigger than the distance from the point x to this optimal set. This situation is very interesting because actually this problem is not non-degenerate, you see? So in Newton method, so we it is very usually very dangerous in Newton method to have degenerate Hessian. So when Hessian is degenerate along some direction, so the Newton method is not well defined. And here it is exactly the case. Since the solution of our problem is not unique, so we definitely have the second derivatives at the solution equal to zero along the tangent directions to this set. So the method is not locally non-degenerate. But still, so with this cubic regularization, so it appears that everything is okay. So again, so let us look, so what we can do. So again, there is a certain level of the objective function, and we say that if we are not here, then there is very fast convergence to this level. So if you look, so the rate of convergence is proportional to 1 over k to the power of 4, just to eliminate the initial residual. But if we are below this level, then we have superlinear rate of convergence. Superlinear rate of convergence, instead of square here, we have power 3 divided by 2. But it is also very fast rate of convergence, and note that two steps of this rate of convergence is are better than one step of quadratic convergence. So if we take delta to the power 3 divided by 2 twice, so we get this smaller than delta to the power square. Not twice. 9 divided by 4. Okay, so this 8. Okay, four times will be definitely enough. Twice this okay. So this is 9 and this is 4. So this is true. Of course. So here we'll have 9 divided by 2. 9 divided by 4, which is bigger than 2. Two steps with this rate of convergence are better than one step of quadratic convergence. Therefore, it is also a very, very fast convergence scheme. So in two steps, we double at least the number of right digits. And this is actually the very unusual results for optimization, because we get superlinear rate of convergence for degenerate functions, for functions which do not have non-degenerate Hessian at the solution. Okay, so just for the people which are interested in the reasons of all these estimates, I want to show you the main tool in the proof. Oh, it is far. So this is mainly the only thing which we use here, this inequality, actually. So both results which were proved at this transparency are based on this property. Okay. Star convex function. Of course, convex function is a particular case of star convex function, so everything of that is true for convex functions. So the next class of problems where we can guarantee good behavior of this Newton method, again, so this is non-convex problems, are so-called gradient-dominated functions. What is it? So this, the definition looks a little bit artificial, but we will see very soon that this is not. So there are important examples when this is true. We just say that instead of convexity, so we assume that difference in the function value between the point x and the optimal point is bounded by a certain norm of the gradient. Okay? So here, the important thing here is this power p. So the power p can be between 1 and 2. And this actually indeed leads to completely different behavior of the optimization method. So this P is called degree of domination. And for example, let us look at convex functions. Okay, for convex function, this is just convexity. So we estimate this by Cauchy-Schwarz. Therefore, we have this inequality. So therefore, tau is equal to R. Okay, and P is equal to 1. So this is a convex function. Second example are strongly convex function. What is strongly convex function? For strongly convex function, we have this inequality. And actually, so for gradient domination, so from this inequality, if y is the optimal solution, so the gradient is equal to 0, and we have the domination of degree 2. And this is the consequence of strong convexity. Actually, I do not prove you usually the inequalities, but this one is indeed very simple. So we say f of x star greater or equal f of x plus f prime of x x star minus x plus how it is called gamma over 2 norm of x minus x star square. Okay, this is the definition of strongly convex function applied to the point x star, and now it remains just to minimize the right hand side in this vector x minus x star. So if we minimize the right hand side, so you get f of x minus 1 over 2 gamma norm of prime of x square, and therefore you get immediately this upper bound. So the strongly convex functions, so they are gradient dominated of degree 2. Okay, so with this constant. Now the third example, so the sum of squares. This is already non-trivial thing. So consider the system of linear equations. Okay, so j of x equal to 0. So and it is non-trivial system of equation in the sense that the number of equation is smaller than the dimension of the vector of variable. Therefore, there is non-trivial, let me say, manifold of the solution of this system of non-linear equation. And we assume that the Jacobian, so what is the Jacobian? So this is the derivative matrix, which is the derivative of this vector function. So this is n by m matrix. And it is, our assumption is, it is uniformly non-degenerate. Uniformly non-degenerate, how we do that? So we multiply, this is the matrix of m by n. Okay, so we multiply it by transpose. We get matrix, square matrix of small size, m by m. And we assume that this matrix is non-degenerate. So this is non-degeneracy condition. So then, if we just look at the sum of squares of the residuals of this function, then so this function is gradient dominated of degree 2. Okay. So the conclusion is that so the functions, if we want to solve the system of nonlinear equations with non-degenerate Jacobian, then it is a good idea to use the construction like that. So this function will be gradient dominated of degree 2, so it will have properties which are typical for the strongly convex function. So and again, so for applications, so there are indeed situations when we can guarantee that our system of nonlinear equation, rather complicated equation, it has uniformly non-degenerate Hessian. And one of interesting example is like that. So if x, our variable is a matrix x, which is has more rows than columns. So we can think, and you can check actually, so that this system of equation, yeah, the system of nonlinear equation in X, yeah, so it has non-degenerate, uniformly non-degenerate Jacobian. So for this system of equation, so non-trivial quadratic equation still, so we have this nice property of gradient domination. Okay, now, so what we can say about the gradient-dominated functions in terms of the rate of convergence? So we need to consider two situations. You remember that, So we have examples for gradient dominated function with p equal to 1 and p equal to 2. So first look at p equal to 1. They are more or less similar, our results, than the results for star convex function, because again, so it is an analog of convex functions. Again, there exist some level, so such that if we are not here, then the rate of convergence is very fast. So look, so the logarithm of this ratio decreases in a linear rate. So this is very fast rate of convergence to the corresponding level. But if we are already here, okay, and remember, so for convex function, what it was tau f. Tau f was the size of the distance to the optimum, something like that. So therefore, this is L r cube somehow, so this level. Yeah, so the same thing as for convex function. Then we have, again, by the same reason, the quadratic rate of convergence proportionally to 1 over k square. Now, this is the gradient domination of degree 1. The gradient domination of degree 2 is much better. So again, we have some switching moment omega tilde. So before this switching moment, our convergence rate is like that, so linear, very fast. Okay, and after that, so we have the superlinear rate of convergence. Superlinear rate of convergence, again, so several iterations of this rate of convergence is equivalent to one step with quadratic convergence. And again, so this superlinear rate of convergence doesn't require that the Hessian at the solution is non-degenerate. So again, so our method is very, very fast. So there is one somehow artificial example of functions for which we can also prove the rate of convergence, but we will look at it just because it is exactly the functions which we usually use as a test function for methods for non-convex optimization. So what is it? So let us assume that we have a mapping of Rn to Rn, and this mapping is non-degenerate. Okay, non-degenerate means that it is invertible. Okay, so and the inverse mapping also exists. Now, let us look at the function f of x, which is formed in this way, where phi is a convex function. So what we are doing? So we have a convex function. We put inside convex function a non-linear transformation of variable. So, and since this transformation is non-degenerate, we do not create local minimums of our new functions. But of course, convexity is lost. Convexity is completely lost. We have very strange level sets of this function, but we can be sure that this function is unimodal. If unimodal, there are no local minimums, and so on. Therefore, we know what is the global minimum of this non-convex function, and therefore we can use it as a test function for different numerical methods. So this is exactly how people construct the test functions, the majority of test functions in nonlinear, non-convex optimization in this way, just to know what is the global solution. It appears that for this function, we also, this type of function, we also can prove the rate of convergence of our method. Indeed, let us look at Lipschitz constants, if you want, so the maximal norm of the derivative of the inverse function. Okay, and assume that it is finite on the level set of our function. It is, okay, reasonable assumption since the method is monotone. Now, so we prove exactly again the following. So if the value of the function is big enough, then after one step, so we are go below this level. So the same story as before. But if we are below this level, then the rate of convergence is proportional to 1 over k. Which means, again, so the confirmation that so this nonlinear transformation of variable, they do not destroy too much the global rate of convergence of this optimization scheme. And now, so there is no convexity at all here in this example. Yeah, and one, so the question is how we can construct such invertible non-degenerate mapping. So this is the usual trick which is used. So we define this mapping in the following way. So the first component of this mapping is x1. The second is x2 plus any function of x1. The third is x3 plus any function of x1 and x2, and so on. The last is xn plus any function of the previous guys. So you see, you can put any nonlinearity here, but if you compute the Jacobian, it will be a triangular matrix with ones at the main diagonal. Therefore, so its determinant is equal to one, and this transformation is non-degenerate. And by the way, so there is a simple way to write down the inverse mapping. Okay, so using the same function phi. You see, so x1 is equal to u1, x2 is equal u2 minus phi1 of u1, and all things like that. So you recursively easily write down the inverse function. Okay, now, so let us speak about the convex case. So what happens if we apply Newton method to convex functions? Yeah, of course, the usual Newton method, so we already analyzed, and we have seen that the rate of convergence is 1 over t squared. But you know that in convex optimization, there is a possibility to accelerate the local schemes using the estimating sequences technique. And here it is exactly what this possibility also works. And I just quickly show you so how what are the differences with respect to the first order method. First of all, so we use another prox function. Prox function in for the first order methods was the squared Euclidean norm. Here we use the cubic Euclidean norm. Now, so the important fact about this prox function is it is uniformly convex. So we discussed already uniform convexity in the previous lecture. So this cubic function satisfies this inequality. Now the norm is the usual Euclidean. Okay, and therefore, so we have this inequality. So a function is uniformly convex. But also, so what is important for us, its Hessian is Lipschitz continuous. If you look at the Hessian of this function, so then this matrix in the matrix norm satisfies the Lipschitz condition with the factor 2. So in all our schemes, we use this d of x in case the standard squared Euclidean norm, which was used for the first order methods. Now, so we construct the estimating sequences again in the same way. So it will be the accumulated linear model of our objective function plus the prox term with certain coefficient. N, big N here is a constant, it is not the number of steps. So in this LK are linear functions. We construct a minimizing sequence f of xk and the sequence of scaling parameters, again, in this way. And the relations which we are going to satisfy are exactly the same. So the value of our function is smaller than the minimum of our estimating functions. Okay, in this case, it is divided by ak. And the estimating function is a lower bound for the combination of the objective function and the initial function d of x. So this is more or less the same style of estimating sequences as in the first order methods. And again, the reason For that is that from these inequalities we easily derive the rate of convergence. Indeed, so if this is true and this is true, then AK f of xk is smaller than that, and this guy is smaller than f of x star, where x star is the solution of our problem. As a result, so we get this inequality, and we divide this inequality by AK, and we have the rate of convergence for our process from derived from the condition for the growth of the coefficients AK, big AK. Okay, so what we can say about the rate of convergence? So finally, so this is, you can maybe guess, so what these are the rules. Rules of the updating point are exactly the same as in the fast gradient method, except this operation. So there are two differences, actually. First, the first difference is that instead of gradient step, we take here the cubic Newton step, and also the rules for the coefficients AK are different. So in our case, so big AK grows much faster than in the case of fast gradient method. The other things are exactly the same. So that our conditions, so they are valid for certain values of these parameters, small ik, and as a consequence, so for our method will be convergent proportionally to 1 over k cube. So for Newton method it was 1 over t square. Now we have the accelerated rate of convergence 1 over t cube, which is already it is very fast, actually. So if you have 100 iterations, you already have here 10 to the minus 6, which is a good accuracy. Now, the schemes, again, it looks very, very similar to the fast gradient method. So the difference, one difference is here. So we have the Newton step, and the second difference is in this coefficient. This is it, and here. All other things are exactly the same. Okay, now, so this rate of convergence, as you can see, so it is proportional to 1 over k cube. So it is fast, but of course it is not as fast as linear rate of convergence. Yeah, so for non-degenerate problem and first order method, so we can have linear rate of convergence. So what are the classes, the problem classes, for which we have linear rate of convergence for the second order scheme? So I just recall you what is the standard non-degenerate functions for the first order scheme. So we just define the bounds, lower and upper bounds for the Hessian. So this is the Lipschitz constant for the gradient. So this guy is the constant of strong convexity. And the ratio of these two guys defines so-called condition number, which is responsible for the rate of convergence of these schemes. And in optimization, so this definition of condition number, it penetrated from linear algebra. Initially, so it was things like that were introduced for matrices. Okay, we're interested in matrices in linear algebra, and they all define this condition number. Now, this condition number has geometric interpretation. So we can look at the angle between the gradient and the direction towards the optimal point. And this condition number tells us that this angle is not very small. I mean, so these guys, they are not very orthogonal. So there is a bound in the right-hand side, which depends on this condition number in the following way. So square root of the condition number. Condition number is typically small, therefore, so the main part here, this is the square root of the condition number. Okay, in an optimization method, so this is very first order optimization method, this is indeed very important characteristic of optimization problems. Now, just because the usual gradient method, they have the number of iterations proportional to one over condition number, and the fast gradient method, so the estimate is much better. We take the square root of the condition number and multiply by the logarithm of the epsilon. Now, what happens with the second order schemes? It appears that this theory, or this classification of problems for the second order scheme, doesn't work at all. Okay, so this condition number means nothing for the second order method, and the reason is the right-hand side of our inequality, which we use in order to say how quickly so we can get approximate solution of our problem. Look, so what do we have here with this? L2 is a Lipschitz constant for the Hessian of our problem. And this means that if we add to our function f any quadratic function, for example, the squared linear function, then the Hessian of this new function will be f2 prime of x plus k a transpose, and this constant term, it disappears in this difference, which means that the Lipschitz constant for the Hessian of our new function so will be the same. However, actually, by this operation, you can completely destroy the initial condition number of our function. So with this addition, so most probably the minimal eigenvalue will be not affected, yeah, because this is a linear function, so it is zero along n minus one dimensional subspace, so very big subspace. But we definitely change the maximal eigenvalue, because this coefficient can be arbitrarily high. So this L1 for this new function will be very big. Condition number will be very small, and problems becomes very degenerate from the viewpoint of the standard geometric interpretation. But for the second order methods, this means nothing. So the complexity of our problem is not changing after this transformation. Yeah? So in some sense, so the second order scheme, they eliminate the quadratic part of the objective in one step. After that, they are fighting with the third derivative, and therefore the rate of convergence depends only on the size of the third derivative. It doesn't depend on the size of the second derivative. So second order method do not care about that. Okay, fine. So this is the observation, but what we can do now? So how we can define the non-degenerate problem for the second order scheme? So it can be done actually using the following condition. First, of course, we keep this Lipschitz continuity of the Hessian, but now we assume also that our function is uniformly convex of degree 3. You remember the definition of uniform convexity and where they arise, all things like that. So why we say that this is a non-degenerate problem for second order scheme? So just because, let us look at the corresponding condition number, which we define as sigma 2 divided by L2. And we call it the condition number for the second order method. Okay, so this condition number is invariant with respect to addition of convex quadratic function. Okay, and actually there are examples of functions like that. Like, you remember this is g is D was the cube of the Euclidean norm, this function D, which we discussed here. Now, why do we say that this is an easy class for the second order methods? Let us look. So from uniform convexity, we know that sigma 2 divided by 3, this guy, multiplied by the cube of the distance, is a lower estimate for the function value at the point xk. Xk is the point which is generated by, for example, accelerated Newton method. Now, the difference of the function decreases in this way. Okay? So you see that so approximately we have here this guy divided by k cube. But if we do the number of iterations, k is proportional to some constant, and so it should be L2 divided by sigma 2, the power 1 divided by 3. Okay, if we choose k proportional to this inverse condition number, then from this inequality we will have that the new distance to the optimal point is smaller than a half of this distance. So what we should do? Look, so we need to solve inequality. So 14L2R0 cube. Okay, k divided by k plus 1, k plus 2, less or equal, sigma 3 divided, sigma 2 divided by 6, R0 cube. Okay. If the right hand side of this inequality will be smaller than sigma 2 divided by 6 multiplied by the cube of this distance, then, so from that, we will have that norm of xk minus x star cube less or equal 1/2 norm of x0 minus x star cube. Okay, so the right hand side is smaller than this, so we get this inequality. So in this number of steps, so we divide the distance to the optimum by 2, and after that we can restart. Therefore, so the complexity bound which we get in this situation, this is multiplication of this number, the number which we need to divide the distance by absolute constant, multiplied by logarithm of 1 over epsilon. So you see that epsilon goes inside the logarithm, and the complexity of this problem depends on the second order condition number of our functions, which is very different from the first order. Now, so all this theory, I cannot say that it is very old, so it is really the advances of the last decade, and therefore there are still open questions which we would like to answer about the second order scheme. So first of them is the problem classes. What are the good problem classes? You have seen that we need to introduce new problem classes in order to prove that these methods are efficient and all things like that. So low complexity bounds and optimal methods. So now we have a kind of low complexity bounds. This is already solved, but optimal methods is still a problem. So it appears that the scheme which I showed you today with this rate of convergence, okay, is not exactly, it is a little bit worse than the low complexity bound, and therefore the question, so the lower complexity bounds for the second order schemes is now that fk minus f star greater or equal L R cube divided by K to the power 3.5. This is low complexity bound, and we have 1 over K cube. So it is a little bit slower than this low complexity bound, but okay, so the optimal method is not constructed yet, so the practical optimal method. Now, again, so what is geometric interpretation of non-degenerate problem? So this cubic non-degeneracy is not very standard, and we need some maybe explanation of that. And also the complexity on the strongly convex function, so how to compare this with the complexity of the first order scheme. So also this question is not answered, because now it looks like that we have two different complexity theories. So first is for the first order method, and the second for the second order method. And it is not very good, because we need to have more or less the unified way of treating so the optimization problems. Okay, and also, so can we have in this framework the polynomial time methods? Now, so time goes on. Let me speak quickly about the solving, the method for solving the system of nonlinear equations. So our problem is to find a solution of this system of equations. So this is the vector functions, and we want to have that find the point x for which this vector function is equal to zero. So the usual assumption so for such problem is that the Jacobian of our vector function is Lipschitz continuous. Yes, so the standard way of solving, of addressing this problem is the Gauss-Newton method. Again, so it was developed in the old style, so we just say, okay, let us take a merit function. Okay, merit function actually is necessary just to measure the residual in this system. Okay, and what we do, so we linearize our nonlinear equation at the point x, so we get linear operator which we put inside this merit function, and we minimize it in y. Okay, so again, the idea is that we somehow use the linearization of the of this nonlinear system. In the Newton method, this nonlinear system was that the gradient was equal to zero. Therefore, here we had the second order derivative, and now it is just the vector function equal to zero. Therefore, here we have first derivative. Usual choice is just for function phi, we take the square root of the Euclidean norm. There is no any reason for that except the simplicity. So why not to take the simplest possible merit function? And this is it. So for what we can prove for this standard approach, so usually people prove the local quadratic convergence with some non-degeneracy assumption and strange actually condition on M, so the number of equations must be greater or equal than the number of constraints. And it is strange, but then actually it is not very typical that we can have zero residual for this type of systems. But that's okay. And actually, so the main problem is that for this approach, we do not have any global complexity results at all. So what happens globally for which classes of problems and all things like that? Just nothing. So we can try to improve the situation in the same way as before, just using the following lemma. So we have already seen many times something like that. So the norm of the difference of the value of our nonlinear functions with respect and the linear approximation grows quadratically. So this is the simple observation. From this observation, we can say the following. So let us look at the merit function defined in this way. It is not the square norm, it is, and the norm now is arbitrary. It is just the norm of the residual, arbitrary norm of the residual. Now, using this inequality, we can say that we always have this upper bound for the value of our objective function, merit function. norm of f of y is smaller than norm of this guy plus this quadratic term. So this is just a trivial consequence of this inequality. So what we can do now, of course, we are staying at the point x. Let us minimize this in y. And we will have the improvement of the value of our objective function, f, small f of y. Yeah? Of course, this upper bound may be non-smooth and all things like that, but this is a convex optimization problem. And we can find efficient ways for solving these auxiliary optimization problems. So this gives us the modified Gauss-Newton method. So at each iteration, we minimize this upper bound for our objective function. It is important, again, that here we have norm, not the squared norm, but norm. So if we would square this, so we do not have the approximation result. So here we have the norm, we minimize this difference. And this is it, actually. So this method is monotone. So it always improves the residual of our function unless we are at some stationary point. For this approach, we can prove the local quadratic convergence at non-degenerate condition and also some global efficiency bound. Global efficiency bound would tell us how quickly the norm somehow of the first order optimality conditions for this guy. So it goes to zero. So we have some efficiency estimate. And since the auxiliary problem is convex, so very often it can be easily solved by the standard linear algebra technique, especially if this norm, which we use here, is the standard Euclidean. Okay, now, so let us speak a little bit in the end of this lecture about the way we are testing these second order methods. And for that, we will look at one special function, which actually appears to be quite difficult. So it looks not very difficult in the form which you see at the transparency, but in fact, you will see in a moment it is a very difficult function. So it is constructed more or less at the same way which we discussed some time ago. So in convex function, which is quadratic functions, we do the nonlinear transformation of variable, non-degenerate transformation of variable, and we get non-convex function, but it is unimodular, so there exists only one local solution, which is exactly at the same time the global solution. So from the viewpoint of this, so it is a simple function. There is no local solution again. But it appears that there is some trick inside, so which makes this problem very different, very difficult. Let me show you what is it. Okay, so if you look, so what we want to solve, so we want to solve the following system of equation. X1 is equal to 1. Xi plus 1 is equal to Xi squared minus 1. Okay, this is the system of equations. So it is important what we have here. What is this guy? Okay, I don't know, did you have this in the analysis or not, or somewhere? So this is the Chebyshev polynomial of degree 2, this guy. Chebyshev polynomial of degree 2. And it's in some sense, so if you look what this penalization makes, so we are trying to, let us forget about this, the first equation. Let us look what is the solution of all other equations. Then, so all our guys, the solution of our system will be the function of the first point x1. So if we fix x1, then we can easily write down the all other values which satisfy the system of equations. But it is important, what is this function? So P2 is a Chebyshev polynomial. Okay, so Chebyshev polynomial so has the formulas that is cosine of k or cosine of tau. And therefore, so the nice property of the Chebyshev polynomial is, so if for Chebyshev polynomial, if for Chebyshev polynomial of degree k, you put inside the Chebyshev polynomial of degree m, okay, just from this formula, you get Chebyshev polynomial of degree km. And in this test function, we use this property. Xi plus 1, so the solution of this system, is this is Chebyshev polynomial of degree 2, p2 of xi. P2 xi is the Chebyshev polynomial of xi minus 1, therefore this guy is p4 of what xi minus 1, and so on. So it appears that this guy is a Chebyshev polynomial of degree 2 to the power I of the first function. So the solution of the bottom of this epigraph actually appears to be in terms of this coefficient x1, the Chebyshev polynomial of degree 2 to the power n. So the very oscillating function, which should be difficult for optimization schemes. Okay, but at the same time, so this function looks absolutely innocent. So we do not have big coefficients. So coefficients are 4, 2, so nothing very special. But this trick with Chebyshev polynomial makes it extremely difficult. So clearly, this function is unimodular. So our process starts. So we choose the first coordinate equal to minus 1 to have 1 here, and all others guys are satisfied with this condition, and we need just to travel from minus 1 to 1, not too far. So how we can do this with minimization scheme? So I just show you, okay, this is important, I show you the results, the computational results for this cubic regularization of the Newton method. And at the first glance, they look terrible. Look, so this is the dimension. You have Newton method. So we stop when the norm of the gradient is 10 to the minus 8. And to have a method which is in dimension 15 needs 2 million iterations of the Newton method, this is indeed doesn't look very promising, I should say. So indeed, but in fact, so this is you will see that this is not too bad. It is just a confirmation that the function is very difficult. Each new dimension, so as it should be in for exponential oscillation, so multiplies the complexity of this function by 2. But method works, okay, works somehow, so it comes to the global minimum of this problem. Let us compare it with other approaches. So this is the next slide. And you see here the tables are much shorter. This is the standard, let me say, commercial optimization methods. Table is much shorter because the majority of guys, okay, they just stop on very small, I don't know, dimensions, like 6, 9, okay, just because so they have numerical difficulties. So something doesn't work. So what happens, what is the most, let me say, active guy, so this is the trust region methods, but look at the number of iterations for dimension 12. Okay, it is 2 million already for dimension 12, and here for dimension 12 we had only 170,000 of iterations. And again, so the time which we use have for here is only 2 minutes. And there, so for this guy, it was, I don't know, 40 minutes. To much faster. And actually, so the so we simply didn't do the next experiments because actually the time was absolutely unacceptable. So the conclusion is that indeed with this cubic regularization, so we get quite interesting scheme, so which has some theoretical foundation, and also what is good, so this theoretical, let me say, guarantees, they are confirmed by practical experiments or even for very difficult optimization problems. Okay, so this is it for today, I think. Questions? Yeah?
For this modified Gauss-Newton method, how the auxiliary problem is solved? By duality?
There are different ways, actually. For example, if you have, so you need to minimize norm of f of x plus f prime of x, y minus x, okay, plus, I don't know, L over 2 norm of y minus x squared. So you introduce one additional variable, and you say that you minimize, so this minimization in y. You introduce one additional variable, and you say I minimize in y and in t, and our function is like that. T square over 2 plus 1 over 2 t norm of f of x plus f prime, okay, this guy, squared, plus L over 2 norm of y minus x squared. Okay, so you see, if you mean, so here this is the squared norm. Therefore, in y, this function is quadratic. But if you minimize this in t, no, sorry, it's like this. If you minimize this in t, so you get exactly this norm without square. But now, if you fix t, this is a quadratic function, and you can just solve it by linear algebra. Okay, linear algebra by inverting matrices. The result will be the function dependent on single variables, and there you just do line search. That's it.
We can somehow quantify the rate for t.
T star, actually, somehow, yes, because t star is the norm of f of x plus f prime of x y minus x star again. Okay, so it somehow is related to the current residual or expected residual. So therefore, you can have quite good prediction. For example, you can take the starting point equal to f of x, norm of f of x, and run the Newton method from this stuff. Because the minimization of this thing, so of course, it should be done by the Newton scheme, as usual. One-dimensional Newton, so it is convex function, therefore, everything is very, very fast. Yeah, it would be interesting to check indeed the how it works at some problem, especially what problems, well, this non-degenerate stuff. So maybe what I wrote on the blackboard with matrices. Yeah, there are interesting applications. Yeah.
If we consider the usual cubic Newton method, not the accelerated one, mm-hmm. Can we build an estimating sequence for it?
I don't know, but you mean what? So without accumulation of, I don't know.
I mean, can we provide it with certain termination test?
This stuff. Again, I don't know. I don't know. So the thing maybe which is missing here, yeah, is if you compare the theories for first order method and the second order method. So here we have, you remember, in the first order method, so we have primal gradient method and the dual gradient method. And in this setting, no, I don't know. It seems, well, I have no idea. Can we have here something like the dual Newton method, which works in the dual space and all things like that. So we should start from that maybe, and then to see what can be done in this direction. Yeah. Okay, then that's it. So I don't know where we meet tomorrow, but because So it should be the room which was changed and the thing like that. But ask please the secretary room. Okay.